the high school kids at Queen's University, Kingston. And many, many families are on vacation. So it feels like many people are not here today. I guess that's what happens in the summer. But it's a blessing that you're all here today. So today's gospel is about the healing of the raising of Lazarus from the dead. And the gospel has many messages for us, and the church reads it to us different times throughout the year. Today we want to focus on the issue of here and now. I don't know if you notice a battle that goes on in our lives regarding past, present, and future. I feel that the devil uses the past and the future to keep robbing the possibilities of the present from us, to keep us always going back and forth between past and future, which are both not in our hands. The past is gone, the future hasn't come. So he works with using these two against us all the time to spoil the present, to make us waste time and waste the potential we have to make something out of our future using now. The future, the present, the past. The present is such an important moment that doesn't come back, as you know. It's like time is a precious commodity. St. Paul was very careful in telling us, redeem the time, for the days are evil. Be careful of the time that is being lost. And you'll see in the dialogue between the Lord and Mary and Martha how this occurs with each one of us. It says, Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. So the last part is very good. It's kind of like Martha herself was in a battle between what's happening now in front of her, that Jesus is himself there in front of her, and the past, that if you had been here, Lord, if you would have come in time, Lazarus would have been alive today. So again, this is a crippling effect that the devil uses to make us think of past or future. People want to see. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Of course, that sounds like Jesus talking about the future. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection of the last day. Jesus didn't talk about the resurrection of the last day. He talked about her brother's going to rise again. Of course, she didn't know that he was going to rise again in moments after this dialogue. But, and she had a good faith, I think, well, in the resurrection, in the future. Nothing wrong with that. But still, there's the next part we'll clarify what we're talking about. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? He doesn't ask her, will you believe this? Did you believe this? He didn't say the resurrection of the last day that he was talking about now. I am. I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection of the life. Present. She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is to come into the world. So you can see again through the dialogue between the Lord and Martha, a battle between the past, oh, if you would have been here, and the future, and in the resurrection at the end of time. The Lord is trying to keep us in the present. The Lord is a constant. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, forever. Now Mary, her sister, came where Jesus was and saw him. She fell at his feet saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Exactly the same sentence and the same way of thinking. The past. We lost something. But the Lord is right in front of you. Whether he would have been here 4 days ago or been here in a week, he's right there now talking to you. But unfortunately, even in our prayers, we tend to pray about what's going to come and what happened. We don't talk about now, the Lord. The weeping, and the Jews who came with her weeping. He groaned in the spirit of his trouble, and he said, where have you laid him? The Lord didn't even talk about it. He didn't even have that conversation he had with Martha with her. He just again went, where is he? Where is his body? He didn't say, well, I could have come, but I didn't come because I wanted to have a miracle happen. He just said, where is his body? Let's not focus on past and future. Where is his body? Where have you laid him? Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to the Lord, by this time there is a stench, for he has been dead 4 days. But he's asking her, he didn't say whether or not there was a stench. And I think the Lord knows if there is a stench by now or not. But again, we have a tendency of telling the Lord what to do and giving him advice and telling him, well, you know, no, this is not good, you can't do this now. What do you mean you can't do this now? He knows exactly what he's doing. So she's again talking about it's been 4 days, he's been dead, past and future. Jesus said, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? Now, seeing the glory of God will happen in heaven, that's true. But seeing the glory of God is something that happens every single day, every single moment of our lives. But unfortunately, we don't always recognize or perceive it. But the glory of God is before us all the time. All the time. Here and now. Look at this passage in Exodus. This is the Old Testament, chapter 3. When the Lord is commissioning Moses to go back to Egypt after 40 years and telling Moses, go bring my people out of Egypt, out of slavery, out of bondage. So Moses was amazed by what he saw, and at the same time wasn't sure how he was going to do it, wasn't sure what he was going to tell the people of Israel when they asked him about the Lord. So Moses says to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? What do I say to them when they ask me about what's God's name? Do you remember this? The Lord's answer was, excellent. That's it. He says, I am who I am. He said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am, has sent me to you. Capital I, capital A, capital M. I am. I am now. There was no time God wasn't. There is no time God won't be. God is here and now, all the time, constantly in front of you. From the time of Moses to the time of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, to you and me today, to the end of time. Tell them, I am. He didn't say, I will resurrect you and give you life again. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you want to make a good meditation study, I recommend you open up your Bible or just do a concordance or look up I am in the Bible. See how many times the Lord says, I am, from Old to New Testament, all the way to the book of Revelation. And see that this reminds us that He is always there. This is in John chapter 8. The Pharisees were arguing with the Lord and questioning him as to who he is, where he's from, what is he doing, how old is he, and so on. And the Jews said to him, you are not yet 50 years old and have seen Abraham, because the Lord said to them, your father Abraham saw my name as glad. He saw his day in different ways, but particularly in the Old Testament. So he said, you're not even 50 years old. How has Abraham seen you? And how have you seen Abraham? The Lord's answer was very simple. Most assuredly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. You have to, and I have to, and we have to remind each other that the Lord is. He is now. You have never to worry that he hasn't come yet, or he left us behind, or is not answering. He is there, always. Always, always, to the end of time. He is the great I am. Mother Teresa talks about her encounters with people in her service, and she says, I believe in person to person. Every person is Christ for me. Because the Lord said, when you do it to the least of my brothers, you do it to me. And since there's only one Jesus, that person is the one person in the world at that moment. And she's talking about how when she interacted with people, or when she served people, it was then only now. Because she saw the great I am in them now. And that gives us a lesson in our practical day-to-day. Not to think about, okay, well, I'm talking to a person, oh, I have this to do later. Focus on them now because the great I am is there. He sent them for us to serve, or for us to talk to, for us to listen to. When we're to talk to them, not to think, what have they done to me before in the past? Forget the past, forget the future, focus on now. Here and now, the great I am is there. St. Augustine gives us many messages and lessons on present and being careful with the past and the future. He says, there is no saint without past, no sinner without future. So, unfortunately, the devil tries to trap us into past and future to keep us from repenting from our past and from working towards our future. But every saint who has realized this through the past behind them, repented it, confessed it, and struggle for their future, for their salvation. But the devil again tries to steal us away from that. St. Augustine also says, God has promised forgiveness to your repentance, but he has not promised tomorrow to your procrastination. This is also, again, about past and future. The Lord promises, whoever comes to me, I will by no means cast out. But he doesn't guarantee there will be a tomorrow to repent and tomorrow to struggle. Pope Shenouda used to say, in heaven, the Lord will not ask me why I sinned, he will ask me why I did not repent. So we have now to work. That's why I said, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Don't wait. There may not be a tomorrow. There may not be a next minute. There may not be a next hour. We don't know. That's why we have now, let's use it. He also says, trust the past to God's mercy, the present to God's love, and the future to God's providence. So in other words, leave it all in God's hands. Leave the past to his mercy. Leave the future to his providence. He is the protector. He is the Almighty. And give him the present, trusting in his love. And he loves you, and he knows what he's doing. He knows what he's doing. Yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a mystery. Today is a gift of God, which is why we call it the present. Considering the word present, reminding ourselves of the meaning of a present, is a gift. We have a gift now to use. Let us not waste it. Let's redeem the time for the days are here. And glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.